Hola a todos. I'm Jorge Molina, the programming coordinator for the Los Angeles Latino International Film Festival. First of all, thank you so much for joining us at LALIFF Connect, a festival powered by the Latino Film Institute, dedicated to celebrating Latinx experiences through art, film, TV, music, and the digital space. Today, I am happy to and honored to introduce Paola Magrans for a special masterclass on sound design, to be enjoyed in the safety of your own social distancing spaces. Paola Magrans graduated in 2013 with a BA in Sound for Film and Television from the University of Arts in Cuba. With two feature films under her belt, Paola moved to the US, first working as a live broadcasting mixer, receiving a Los Angeles Emmy Award for Kobe Bryant's Last Game. She went back to sound post-production in TV shows like Better Call Saul and Ozark, winning a Golden Reel Award with the latter. Under the mentorship of nine-time Academy Award nominee Wiley Stateman, Paola integrated the sound team for Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, and the movie earned Academy Award nominations for both sound editing and mixing. Paola's most recent work as sound designer is the independent film The Last Rafter, which was the opening night for LALIFF Connect this past Tuesday. Now, without further ado, here's Paola Magrans. Thank you.
Hola, everybody. I want to apologize for the technical difficulties that we are having. LALIFF Connect is working on it, so I'm sure it will be solved soon. Thank you so much, Jorge, for your introduction. If you just tune in, my name is Paola Magrans. I'm a Cuban sound designer and one of the sound editors of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood and the sound designer of The Last Rafter, El Último Valsero, the opening night film of LALIFF Connect 2020. I want to thank LALIFF for inviting me to do this masterclass, and thank you for tuning in. Well, I came from film school in Havana, and with a lot of luck and support, I ended up working at Wiley's Stateman Studio 24/7 Sound. I started at Wiley's as an assistant sound editor, and one of the biggest things of being an assistant in these big movies is managing stress. You are basically becoming the backbone of your sound team. You have to deal with stuff like there is a file that is missing, there is a session that is not updated, deadlines that need to be met, and you are keeping everybody on track from a folder structure where everything is to a schedule where things are downloading, uploading, and to everything. So you are really giving everybody else that is working there the piece that they rely on. Anything and everything that would come to the studio, you will take care of it. And this is how I learned the basics of becoming a good sound editor and designer. It all started with the structure of the Pro Tools sessions. And this is what I want to show you first. Let me do a screen share. So first, I will talk about the craft and process of SoundPost, the practical side of the work, and then I will dive in into the storytelling concept. So this is a Pro Tools session of the Laugh Rafter, and this is kind of like a mix session. This is everything combined. So the first thing that I like to work when I get into a project is dialogue. And I usually have someone else helping me with dialogue. In this case, for The Last Rafter was Mike Herline. And yeah, he's a great dialogue editor and he helped me a lot. So this is his dialogue track, and so here what we got is a selection of the mics and takes that were the best for using, and so how you can see here we have a combination of boom and laugh, and we have the airfield track too, and sometimes you don't need all the mics, you are just good with the boom or with the laugh or whatever. And as you see, we have different colors. I like to color code things. And luckily, Mike likes to do the same. So it's always great to work with someone as organized as you. And so the next scene, it's I think the FUD scene. These tracks are tracks that need to be FUDs. In this case was for a TV, so we record someone like playing a TV anchor, and and we actually see it through the TV. So we force it to seem like it's coming from the TV. And after that, we have the ADR tracks. These are usually groups. And here, this is a scene that we are going to watch later. This is the scene when where we have a paramedic, and these are the radio that comes from the ambulance. So yeah, we got actors to play those characters that are only sounding. We don't see them. We just listen to them. And so after that, what I like to work on is in backgrounds. I have my background tracks right here. Let me see. So here, we got the backgrounds, and I like to have different like batch of backgrounds. I usually give a first pass to the movie, and after I'm done with that and give them a second pass, I add like a second batch of backgrounds, and probably a third batch in a third like spotting session or something. Like I feel like it's missing something, so I add more. And I do this because I don't like to have all of the backgrounds on the same VCR. And as you see here, we have our third batch that is like wind, water, air, cities. The second batch is more like people talking and those kind of things. And the third batch is, I don't even remember what is this, but yeah, some like car buys and more specific car buys. So yeah, after I give a first pass to all my backgrounds, I start working on effects. And usually I go first for the effects that you can see, kind of like doors or cars or those kind of things. And like work on more like the practical effects. And as same as the backgrounds, we have different batches of effects. I get a lot of effects, and in this scene, this is the first scene, we are gonna watch this scene later. We have the boat, we have the ocean, we have the underwater, I mean, effects. We have like the boat, and yeah, so yeah, we're gonna watch this thing later, so you can listen to all these backgrounds. And here probably like we got like hand pads and body touching, and this is because we didn't have enough budget to record a lot of Foley, so we got almost everything on effects. So yeah, here you see I have a bunch of effect track, and after that, like I work on my designs. And for me, the designs are like drones or symbols or the kind of sounds that you can't point to something and say that that's coming from there, are more this kind of like metaphoric sound, like yeah, drones and symbols and those kind of things that can be sometimes confused with music too. So yeah, and here like this siren, this is a siren that I probably created, and maybe I didn't like it enough, so I just muted and made another one, or got another one from a library. And but I didn't delete it because I wanted to show it to the director, or I wasn't sure if I was going to use that or to use the one that we ended using. So yeah, I do that a lot. Like I just mute my effects. So if I want to, if I'm not sure about them, so if I want to give them a second shot or want to show them to a colleague or the director or that, like I still have it in the session and I don't have to go back and create it again. So yeah, this is my proto sessions. I know that we are missing the music here, and we are missing Foley. Actually, I have Foley right here. But yeah, because in this film, we didn't like record a lot of Foley. We only did like footsteps or like some specific Foley that it was hard to get an effect. So we record those. And yeah, and we didn't have the final music on this scene, on this session. So that's why I don't have it there. So yeah, this is how a Pro Tools session from me in the last Rafter looks like. So moving into storytelling through sound, I want to start with something that Wiley always says, and it's great sound lives somewhere between the science of audio and the subjectivity of storytelling. The science part is really well known, and it's been perfected over many, many years with a lot of talented artists and artisans. But the story part, that's what's really excites me, and that's why I want to talk to you about it. We create sound combining libraries and recording of anything you can think of. In Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, we record all the cars. It was super important to Quentin to have the exact car sound of that era. So we got one day and record 8 cars on the back street of the Spawn Ranch set. We brought 5 recording setups, and in one long day, we made libraries of all the cars, especially the Ford Galaxy that we named the Creepy Crawler, because this is another character in the movie. This is the car in which the Mason family drives up to Rick's house. So my amazing friends and sound designers, Zach Goheim and Leo Marcil, were conducting the recordings and mic setups. We had multiple mic positions at the same time. We had 2 mics on the engine, 2 mics on the exhaust. We had a 6-channel mic on the interior of the car, and 4 boomers from outside the cars getting different perspective. For the creepy crawler, we wanted to get all the rattling on the mechanism, the movement for itself without the engine. So we point the front of the car downhill, and we had the driver throw it in neutral, and we stuck the mics out of the window to get all those mechanism sound. And even though we record a lot, we were not exclusively relying on these recordings on editorial. We were augmenting with other records. We were trying to make it feel like a sinister sounding car. Harry Cohen was the one in charge of car editorials. And as I mentioned, this car is a character by itself, so he took a special care of it. We put additional layers on top of the car recordings. There are all kind of stuff that you can find on that Pro Tools session. There is a layer of a ball shaking in a can. There are some low processing to bring up the muffler sound. There is an old motor boat and an old noisy steam engine sound too. And he layered all this together, and that's the creepy crawler. So let me see if we can take a look to this Once Upon a Time in Hollywood scene, and you can see what I'm talking about.
Private road and property taxes up the butt. God damn.
Bunch of goddamn fucking hippies. What the fuck?
Hey, you! Yeah, asshole! I'm talking to you! What the hell do you think you're doing bringing that noisy hunk of shit around here at midnight? This is a private road, all right?
Who are you? And who are you here to see, huh?
Nobody, sir. We just got lost and a little turned around.
Oh, horse shit. Fucking hippies came up here to smoke dope on a dark road, huh? Next time you want to try that, fix your fucking muffler.
Look, we're really sorry we disturbed you.
Look, Chief, you don't belong here. Now take this mechanical asshole and get it off my fucking street!
So let's watch it again so we can talk about it. This scene has an interesting sound point. The car starts approaching and we hear the mechanical jalopy sound of the Ford Galaxy driving up. Here the sound directs the action of the scene from the get-go. The creepy crawler comes up into her face very slowly, making this mechanical noise. And we create this noise from scratch to make a seamless transition to when he got to the blender making the same kind of noise. So here we have the same kind of mechanical noise, so he doesn't notice that the car is there until he turns off the blender, and then he hears that there's a shitty cat outside.
Damn. Fucking private road.
Also, the sound edited on this scene, when he stepped out of the to the street, it defines logic. He shut off the blender and heard the car noise and walked towards the window, and the sound gradually gets louder. But when he stepped out, we bring it back down again so we can turn it up as he walked into the car.
Noisy hunk of shit around here at midnight. This is a private road, all right? Who are you? And who are you here to see, huh?
Nobody, sir. We just got lost and a little turned around.
Oh, horse shit.
So sometimes you have to break the rules of audible physics for the sake of storytelling. So on the last Rafter, we got a few cars as well, but we didn't have the budget or time to record the actual sound of them. So we had to rely the editing of these cars only on library. Let's watch one scene and we can chat a little bit more about it.
Bueno, a ver. Tú conociste un tipo en un café y te fuiste a tomar una copa de vino con él.
Coño, vale, hacer. Dicho así, parece otra cosa. El tipo es un intelectual y está muy conectado con gente de aquí.
On this scene, you can see that we got Alice's character. Alice is Ernesto's best friend, and this is a guy that he always have to show off, and he always have to trick people, and his car represent power, and it represent that he want to eat the city, and of course, this car in a different film will be a Lamborghini or a Ferrari, but in this, we had a Ford Mustang that it's need to feel like it's the kind of the king of the world. And that's also Ale. He's a Ford Mustang that think that he's a Ferrari. And even when we are just talking about car engines, what we are really talking about is a story. So the next thing that I wanted to share with you is one of my favorite scenes in terms of sound from The Last Rafter, and it's actually the open scene for this film.
Mira, ¿vas a sacar agua? Polo, mira esto. Mira eso, Cere.
¿Qué pasa? ¿Qué pasa?
¡Llegamos, Cere, cojones!
¡Se la ayuda, bro! ¡Se la ayuda,
¡Ay, ¿qué pasó, chico?
¿Esa no es la fiana?
Opa, opa, la mona, vamos.
Rema.
No, que aquí no pilla. Remo, vamos tirando, que estamos ahí mismo.
¡Tírate, no pilles tu burón! ¡Usted está loco,
me mierda, bro! ¡Hay que tirarse!
Dale, saca la bandera.
¿Qué bandera? ¡Ni qué cojones!
¡La bandera, que llegamos, coño!
¡Obama! ¡Obama!
¡Raúl, Sere, que Obama, ni que tío!
¡Obama, coño, que vivo Obama!
¡Obama aquí!
¡Obama!
I hope you guys enjoyed this scene. It's one of my favorite scenes in terms of sound. And I want to try something with you again. I want to play the scene back again, but this time with not sound, so I can talk, well, with the sound lower, I can talk over it and I can explain with you what, to you guys what we did. In terms of sound here, so screen share again, and
so here we are. So we start the scene with listening to the open ocean, but it's not like a day at the beach. We always wanted to have this underbelly of something wrong, something risky is happening here, so you don't hear anything else other than the big waves. And then we go underwater and we are inside this metaphoric moment when the snow globe falls into the water, which encapsulates the model of the film. It's, of course, like the Rosebud reference of To Citizen Kane. Then we are out to the surface with the fight they have. So we decide to focus on the fight and just have the water crashing very gently into this small motorboat. We use the sound of the engine that is clunky and it's not always running to help achieve the passage of time during that scene. So in the next shot, we are going to see that these are just three guys in a little boat, really in the middle of nowhere. So the audience need to feel that. And that's why you can hear the sound of the boat from far away in the distance. This boat represents the rickety situation. The boat is their fears. The boat represents how small they are against the immensity of the ocean. And that's a metaphor of everything else that's going to happen in the film. So we wanted to reflect that through sound as well. Then see Miami for the first time. There is a change in the music. We always knew that we want the music to infuse joy, but keeping the tension. In the sense of will they be able to make it or not? But of course, soon enough, there's another manance, and this is something that in a low budget movie, sound has to step up and create that atmosphere. In this scene, you see the police speedboat for a moment and then you're out. But you still listen to it surrounding the raft. We add the roaring engine, the siren, and the police shouting through the megaphone. It's our job to make it sound in such an immersive way that so the audience feel for the three guys in the little boat. So that's the work that you have to do as a sound designer to enhance the storytelling. We need to create a world. We need to help the director to reach the audience and get the audience to suspend their disbelief and be immersive in the world of the movie.
This is another scene that I wanted to show with you guys, to share with you guys. And this is a scene more towards at the end of the movie. So we have it here. And let's see how it sounds.
Vital sign, check out fine. Are you okay, buddy? ¿Hablas español? ¿Cómo te sientes?
Estoy bien.
Tuviste suerte. Al parecer no tienes nada. Necesito tu ID.
Yo no tengo documento.
¿Sabes lo que va a pasar si te llevo al hospital?
No me importa.
Voy a llenar unos papeles por 5 minutos.
It sounded natural, right? Sounded like it belongs there. So now listen to how it was actually recorded.
Vital sign, check out fine. Are you okay, buddy? ¿Hablas español? ¿Cómo te sientes?
Estoy bien.
Tuviste suerte. Al parecer no tienes nada. Necesito tu ID.
Yo no tengo documento.
¿Sabes lo que va a pasar si te llevo al hospital?
And of course, it always helped to have great production sound. So I want to thank Ariel Novo and Daphne Guisado for doing such a great job in the Laugh Rafter.
So in this case, you have the city, you have the radio dispatcher, and